guys, it's Dad from Be Mommy With Style and welcome back to Vlogmas. So today we're gonna have a chatty vlog and we're gonna talk about all of the most frequently asked Disney questions that I typically get when I'm sharing our Disney vacations or Disney planning videos. And we're gonna dive into those. So if you have any other Disney topic videos you'd like to see or any other Disney questions you'd like to have answered, just let me know down in the comments and I can tackle those during Vlogmas as well, because we are planning on vlogging or having a vlog posted every single day. I'm excited to be back and doing this kind of traditional type of vlog series. So let's dive right in and talk about some of the most frequently asked Disney questions that I get when we post up our Disney vlogs. So first things first, the first thing I always get asked whenever I'm posting about Disney is people always want to know, when are we going next? So I feel like we are very fortunate to have been able to go as many times as we were able to in 2020, with this year being kind of so abnormal as it was. We were able to go to Walt Disney World twice and actually go on a Disney cruise at the beginning of the year as well, even though it seemed like 2 or 3 years ago, it was in 2020. And so we're very, very fortunate because Disney Cruise Line is not running right now and it hasn't been for a majority of the year. So we were in that very small segment of people that got to go on a Disney cruise this year, so that's amazing. So looking ahead to 2021, we do not have a trip booked yet, but I do feel strongly we will be back at Walt Disney World. In addition to Walt Disney World, I don't really know what else is in store for us. I had kind of thought before anything happened with this pandemic that we would go on a Disney cruise at the end of this year. Obviously that did not happen. I don't even know when Disney Cruise Line is going to be back going again. So I feel like kind of stepping out and going that kind of next step, like a longer cruise or going to Alani, probably a little bit on hold right now. But I do feel like we will be back at Walt Disney World at some point in 2021. I just don't know when it's going to be yet. Maybe spring break, it may be later in the summer, maybe a fall trip again. We really enjoy going at a lot of different times of the year, so it's to be determined and yet to be planned. So that brings me to the next question that I get a lot when I'm sharing our Disney vacations and when I'm sharing that we have gone multiple times a year. People like to know a lot of times, how do you plan for these Disney vacations and how do you save up for them? So again, we're very, very fortunate that we've gotten invited to a number of Disney events in the past, and that obviously really, really helps as far as having certain experiences be comped and those sorts of things. But we also go on a number of Disney vacations at least one time a year on our own as a family. And so I can share a little bit about planning for those types of trips and some suggestions that I have for you if you're trying to figure out how to save up and how to kind of set that money aside to have a vacation fund. I've actually found out that even though it's a little crazy having everyone home and very, very difficult to make videos, right now has actually been a really great time to save money because we don't have expenses like childcare. My husband and I have both fortunately still been able to work. I'm still able to do all the extra things that I do to have a residual income, like make YouTube videos. I also sell Scentsy, and I have a few other ways that I make just affiliate type income through those different realms. So that being said, things like that idea, if you are inclined to do those sorts of things, they are a really great way to have like kind of a side hustle or a side project and use all of those funds to go towards your Disney vacation. So even just simply what I make through Scentsy, so even if you know, like YouTube videos would not be your thing or you don't want to start a blog, even just what I make from Scentsy, if I saved it up in a year, then it would completely cover a Disney trip for our family, which is amazing. And as an asterisk, I have to put a disclaimer, anytime I talk about Scentsy earnings, that everyone's earnings with Scentsy may be very, very different. But I'm super fortunate to be a part of a team that has a lot of support and backing. There's 23 people on our specific team, and I'm a superstar consultant, so it's been a really, really great fit. And I don't have to post a lot about it on my social media and that sort of thing. Like, I've been able to very naturally kind of build it over time. And it's been amazing for our family because every little bit helps, especially in this very abnormal situation. So if you can have kind of that side hustle that's in addition to whatever covers your normal household expenses, I find that that works really, really well for me to be able to put that aside to pay for things like furniture. Most of the furniture in our house, especially if it's something that I've shown since I started doing YouTube videos, I've actually purchased that from money that I've made from YouTube, which is fantastic. things like extra Christmas trees, anything like that, really can be funded through a side hustle. So I'm a big believer in that. I'm a big believer in having like residual and passive income, and however works for you, that's a great way to kind of think about, you know, how else you can do it. Another great way I would suggest is, I used to have an eBay store. I don't think this is something I really ever really talked about on my channel very much, but way back before I even started YouTube, I always had this idea of having a lot of different things going and having a lot of different streams of income. I'm a huge, huge believer in that and always have been. I opened up a dance studio and was a sole proprietor of a dance studio right after college. And I actually started a dance store, like a dance wear store, as a part of that. And so I had a physical store inside of my dance studio, but I actually started selling things online. And it took off really, really well. And at one point, my husband and I got married, and I could tell we were going to start moving around for his job a lot, which turned out to be really, really good, because about 6 months after I sold my dance studio, we ended up moving from Illinois to Michigan, so we did end up moving a lot. But I sold the dance studio portion to a new owner that she could take it over and run with it and do whatever she ended up doing with it. And I kept the dancewear business, and so for a few years there, while we were kind of moving a lot right there in the beginning, especially for my husband's job, I ran the dancewear business, and it was primarily on eBay, because at that time, like, websites were a very, very new thing. So I was primarily on eBay, sold thousands of items, and it was a really, really great stream of income. So after that, on a few different avenues, I started Bags for Bubbles, and before I even did Bags for Bubbles, I actually was in the business of flipping handbags. I would find handbags, rehab them, I could authenticate them at that point. I would not recommend this now at this point because fakes have gotten so good, that's why I got out of it. But I hit a really good stride when I was in grad school of being able to find bags that were listed very poorly because I was good at SEO, which is search engine optimization, and I kind of knew what people would be looking for, and I kind of knew the mistakes that people would be making when they list things kind of badly. And so I was able to kind of almost start a little business there flipping handbags and, you know, make some extra income while I was in grad school. So that was awesome. I was also a graduate research assistant. So it's that whole idea of always having multiple income streams. And that's why I am very passionate about like working outside the home, but I still have all these other projects that I do as well. It's because I very much believe in having more income streams. So I would highly recommend any of those ideas. The types of ideas like selling things on eBay, you know, things you have around your house you're not using anymore, clothes you don't wear anymore, on Mercari, on eBay, on Poshmark, all those sorts of places you can kind of get some extra money and stow it away to be your Disney fund. So hopefully that gives you some ideas, and I get asked that question a lot, especially on older videos, but I think a side hustle is definitely a great way, other than just obviously saving a portion of what you make every month. For some people, it's more or less of an option, so I wanted to give some other ideas beyond just, well, put, you know, $400 a month away out of your paycheck or whatever. Those are really great ideas to kind of have something additional. The next question that I get a lot is about kind of how we plan our trips and what really works. And obviously planning right now is very, very different. So I'm kind of just gonna talk about kind of the 1,000-foot view, but I keep my planning very, very simple. So I have just like a blank notepad here. I will keep it very, very simple and just kind of write down a very basis of the dates I think that we'll go, where I think we'll wanna eat, which parks I think we'll go to, and I'll start moving everything around. And then from there, I use that sheet of paper to go and look. Right now, you need the reservation system to be able to look, make sure the park day is available to reserve it. I would use it when I was looking for reservations for things like dining or Bibbidi Bobbidi Boutique, and make sure I didn't need to flip any days around because of availability, and really start to drop my schedule down. So really, it is so easy. I just started on a piece of paper. I would say, like, you know, if we're gonna be there Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, this is what I think we wanna do this day, and then just really start writing notes out to myself about availability. Then as I start getting, you know, really into it and things start getting set more in stone, I might have like my, you know, planner where I actually sit with the calendar and write it out day by day and actually make like a Disney planning sheet. But it's really Disney planning, it can be as complicated or as easy as you want to make it. My advice to you is if you want to plan your own trip and, you know, really take charge of your own reservations, sign up for My Disney Experience if you haven't already, and really spend some time looking around on the website. Go through places to stay, put in some test dates, check out what the different prices are and what the different promotions are, and really get a sense for what's available. You know, check out the moderate resorts and see what the amenities are. Check out some deluxe resorts and see what's gonna fit your family the best. And then when you're looking at dining reservations, put in a date. And like, say you want to go for lunch or you want to go for dinner, put in that time period to see everything that's available. If something new that you may have never thought to try might pop up. Or if you know you really want to go eat a Be Our Guest, go right to the Be Our Guest page and start searching through dates to see what date fits when you're going to be there. So there's a lot of different ways to plan a trip to Disney, and they've made it very, very intuitive. So those would be some of my top tips for planning. And I, of course, when we get down to when we are planning our next trip, I can kind of share more planning tips around that time specifically, because like I said, things have changed. Some of the time links from when you need to make dining reservations have changed. Some of the things like fast pass reservations have changed. Some things have been added, like the park day reservations right now. But overall, the Disney planning process is still very intuitive and very easy to use. So those would be my top tips for planning. The next question that I get a lot are about activities to do with our family. And I actually get a lot of kind of people that are like, I can't believe like you're going to Disney again. Like, what are you possibly gonna do that you didn't do last time? And so my answer to that is always, well, quite a bit. We usually always try to stay somewhere different. We usually always try to have at least a few different dining reservations we never tried before. And really, I can say with confidence, like every single trip when you go to Walt Disney World, it feels different from the last one. It works really well for our family because my husband's not really like a go to a random city and like go do a bunch of random stuff type of person. He really wants to have like a set itinerary and like a set time we're going to do things and really a good idea of what's ahead. Like for Alani, like if we were going to go fly out there, like I would plan out a full itinerary. Like we're going to go do like this tour on this day, we need to rent a car and go here and really have all that planned out. Disney works well because it's a different experience every time, but it's relaxing because some of that kind of planning is taken off of me because it's just kind of inherent to being there. We know how to move around and all that. But then it's kind of easy because I can just say, look at My Disney Experience, and it's all connected and everyone can see the itinerary. So it works really, really well. But as far as how to make our trips different, like I said, staying someplace different, a different Disney resort every single time, really makes the trip feel differently. Going at a different time of year makes the trip feel very, very different. If you go at Halloween versus Christmas, it's a different trip. So that really kind of changes things up. And then of course, trying new things like new rides. There's usually always one new ride when we're there, even as much as we go. New rides, new dining, any sort of new experiences, just kind of add a little bit of flavor to that trip that's a little bit different than the last. So that being said, as many times as you've seen us go to Disney, we have stayed at so many different resorts and we still have not even touched over half of the resorts available. Like we probably have stayed at about maybe a third of the resorts total and like not even scratched the surface at the number of room combinations there are. Because don't forget, even though we've stayed at Art of Animation in the Little Mermaid room, there's still two other sections with the family suites and the Cars area and the Nemo area that are completely different feel at the same resort. So there's so many different combinations that you can unlock when you stay there. That's really how you make it a different trip. The last thing I would kind of tackle are our favorites. And I kind of talk about this in all of our recaps, but just to recap the recaps, if you haven't watched those recently, you know, we've stayed at a lot of different levels. I feel like we have a good handle on what all of the value, the moderates, and some of the deluxes have to offer. And I would say with confidence at this point that I know kind of what our family's like top 3 to 5 resorts are and where we really would want to stay again and where we would want to stay in the future. So we just stayed at Pop on this last trip. I feel like I have, you know, I can say with confidence, I know it has to offer. It was a very comfortable trip. So if you're looking at staying somewhere like Art of Animation or Pop, I think it's a really cool trip. It's very, very comfortable. For us, you know, I feel like the best, and I don't even feel like it's a value, so I hate to say this, but the best value for us has been Art of Animation. It's so unique. It's got like that 90s animation. We love it. and we love those big characters. It's been the best one, but I also feel like it's the most expensive value and it's not really technically value. But anyhow, that one's probably been our favorite. Out of the moderates, I feel like we could stay at a moderate every single time and have a great trip. I really like Caribbean Beach Resort. That we've stayed at Port Orleans Riverside a few different times and had great trips there both times. And every trip has felt different because one time we were in the Bayou rooms, the next time we were in the Princess rooms, we still never stayed in the Magnolia rooms. So you can make different trips by staying in different sections and that sort of thing. We really like Riverside and went ahead the boats, which are, I don't think they're available right now, but boats go over to Disney Springs, that's really convenient. As far as deluxes, we've only stayed at a few of those as a family. I'm really wanting to get everyone to Beach Club because everyone thinks that they're not going to like it. I think they really are going to like it. My husband also wants to stay at Wilderness Lodge. We haven't stayed at that one yet, but we did eat there, which I think is what kind of piqued his curiosity. We have stayed at Animal Kingdom Lodge. It is our family's probably favorite resort, and we absolutely will stay there again. We love the animal watching. We are Animal Kingdom people. So this is a really good fit for us. So that's some of our favorites. Favorite meals is really tough right now because a lot of them are closed because they're character meals, but there's still a lot of great meals available. So Topolino's Terrace was a really, really great meal, and it's actually one that has characters socially distanced right now, so I definitely recommend that. When it opens back up, 1900 Park Fair, we love that one. We will continue to do that one. It's just a really great dinner and super, super fun. We also really like Chef Mickey's. We usually go there for breakfast, and it's usually really, really great. And Ohana is another favorite. I hope to see that one come back, and I'm hoping to stay at the Polynesian at some point. So I'm hoping to see that all come back at some point. So that being said, that's kind of just a recap, and I've talked a little bit about that in some of our other videos, but I thought it'd be great to share in this one too. So those are some of the most frequently asked Disney questions that we get when we share our Disney vacations. I hope there's been some helpful tips there for you. Let me know if you have any other questions that I can answer during Vlogmas down below. And thanks for watching. Have a great day.